Well, we don't hear.
Well, look at that. Look at that.
Thank you.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in resurrection. just thank you this morning. We praise your name. We believe in everything that you do for us. Thank you that you're breath in our arms and that you are the one that gives us strength. I just pray that everything that we do now, during this time together and in the coming days, that we would attempt to do it in a way that is honoring towards you. And I just pray once again that you would just bless this time that we have together with good communion and fellowship. In your name I pray. Amen.
The scripture reading this morning is from John 1, verse 29-42. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man comes after me who has surpassed me, because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man with whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying and spent the day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah." That is the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. And Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which translated is Peter.
Well, if you haven't noticed, we've been following the passages that lead up, or not lead up, but like starting at Christmas, we've been moving our way through John, and it's interesting. The great thing about the New Testament and the Gospel is that we have four different accounts of like the life of Jesus and all that. And so that account of Jesus and John meeting and John telling people that that's God's Son and everything, in the version that is in Matthew, that's where Jesus actually gets baptized by John. And so it's important, or it's interesting to know that the reasoning that Jesus gave to John was that it was righteous and the right thing to do to get baptized. Even though he was God's son, he didn't need to be baptized. Jesus was already showing that example of just doing what is honoring and right. And so it's important for us to continue following that thought and just the way of doing things and always seeking to do the right thing that Jesus has set the example for. So I encourage you to think about the ways that Jesus continues to model that example for us as we continue to sing together.
Yeah. Father God, we come to you this morning. We just thank you for being our God. We thank you for your love, for your grace, for giving us that grace when we did not deserve it. God, we just lift ourselves up to you this morning, individually and as a corporate body, as a body of worshipers, as a body of believers, as a body of followers, Lord. Lord, we lift up praises to you. We thank you for everything that you do for us. And Father, we also lift up prayers of concern, prayers of asking for help, for intervention. Father God, this morning I just lift up each and every person here, each and every person watching. Father God, whatever might be in their hearts, whatever might be in their minds, I just ask you to be with us. Help us. If there's something that we need to repent of, Lord, please show us. Help us to do that, Lord. Father, I lift up those who are hurting this morning, those who are maybe have ailments or sick or are healing, Lord. We know you're the great physician, you're the great healer. You are our hope. Father God, as we heal, whether it's physical, whether it's spiritually, whether it's whatever it is, Lord, we ask for your guidance. We ask for your help in just showing you to the world, but also to ourselves, that we may be the people we should be, that we need to be, so that we may follow you and show others the way. God, as we're here today, as we're worshiping you, as we're praising you this morning, I just ask. We know you're here. Be with us in a mighty way. Your Holy Spirit is here. Just convict us, guide us, and love us in the way that we know only you can. Love you. We just pray this in your name. Amen. You may be seated. Also, just want to point out in the bulletin, there is a preparing ourselves for corporate call to prayer. So if you don't normally take your bulletins home, please take them home as you read through the corporate call to prayer. And it's just things to help us as we go before God, as we go before God in prayer and in lifting ourselves and lifting others up to Him. Things that we can do to prepare ourselves. So please.
If you haven't had a chance, or if you don't sort of Facebook it, haven't had a chance to sign up on Facebook, there is a sign-up sheet let them know that you're coming. Now, you'll notice that this week's call to prayer has been deferred to next week, and we did this because of the anticipated weather conditions and that we would have a lower attendance than normal. And we
appear to be right.
Pardon?
We appear to be right.
We appear to be right, yes. This is serious. We need a full complement for this time. This is a time in prayer, corporate prayer, that we can pray through what unifies us. That we can look at all of the circumstances of our church and all of the parts of our human institution, the church, the bride of Christ and the church that is a human institution, that we can look at all of those things in the light of the scope of all eternity, where we can call an anointing from the Holy Spirit, and where we can receive a word on which direction we should be going, and where we can hold our leadership up in prayer. They need it desperately. And so I would really encourage everyone to prepare themselves this week and to look at what unifies us, what not what divides us. And we look forward to having that time of corporate prayer next week. And we hope that those of you watching on Facebook will also hold this church up in prayer, that you would pray for an anointing of the Holy Spirit, a special anointing, as we seek which direction to go in. Thank you.
Well, with that said, it's offering time.
Woo-hoo!
Though we're small in number today, we're here to give back to you and we're here for you. And I just thank you that you're blessed and that we're able to have the privilege to be able to give. And I just thank you that no matter how much it is, whether it's bigger or small, you accept our gifts as long as we present them humbly. And so I just thank you once again that we're able to do this in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
All right, we are continuing this week in our sermon series on Moses, entitled "A Long Time Ago in a Desert Far, Far Away." And we last week we looked at Moses as the new hope of Israel, of the Israelites who had been in Egypt for around 400 years, and they had become slaves. And we looked at how that reasoning that happened, and just how they became slaves, and now they were fully slaves of the Egyptians, and they were looking for a way out, a hope, just some way to get out of the slavery they were in. And Moses was born. Moses came. Moses was a new hope for the people. Now, they didn't know it at the time, but Moses was the new hope for the Israelites. And today we are going to look at a little bit about Moses, his how he was, what he did, and just what kind of person Moses was as a youth and as a kind of a middle-aged person. We're going to span a long time in this time that we have together today. I want to make sure you have your three B's of the sermon. Do you all have your Bibles? Or if you don't have a Bible, is there one nearby? Do you have your brains? Everyone got their brains? Are they engaged? All right, and you have something to write with so you can take notes. All right, let's go. If we go to the next slide. This is a quote from Henry Blackaby from Experiencing God. And he says, "You never find God asking persons to dream up what they want to do for him. Without doubt, the most important factor in each biblical situation was not what the individual wanted to do for God. The most important factor, not the only factor, the most important factor was what God was about to do." And that's very important when we look at the story of Moses. Because it wasn't necessarily what Moses wanted to do, but it's what God was about to do through Moses. So if we go to the next slide, I want you to think about, what doubts do you have in your everyday life? Today, this sermon title, I don't know if I mentioned it, but if not, it's Moses and Doubt, the Phantom Menace. Doubt. What is doubt? I think we all know what doubt is. I think I forgot to change the coloring on the definition, but I will read that for you. The definition is to be uncertain about, to consider questionable or unlikely, or to hesitate to believe. It's to be uncertain about something, to be undecided in opinion or belief. So that is doubt. It's to not be sure. It's to be undecided. It's to be uncertain about something. Now, if we look at Moses' history, if you'll turn to Exodus 2 for me. We know that all the young Israelite boys who were born were to be murdered. No other way to put it. They were to be murdered because the Pharaoh didn't want them to grow up and to be able to fight against him with all the people and everything. So he was born. His mother hid him. When she could no longer hide him, she put him in a basket and floated him down the Nile, the river. And verse 5, when the Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the riverbank, she saw the basket among the reeds and sent her female slaves to get it. She opened it and saw the baby. He was crying. She felt sorry for him. "This is one of the Hebrew babies," she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" "Yes, go," she answered. And the girl went and got the baby's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this baby and nurse him for me. I will pay you." So the woman took the baby and nursed him. When the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, "I drew him out of the water." So Moses probably grew, when he grew up, you know, he was found. He was born, he was found. He went back to his original family. His own mother raised him. She got to, it doesn't say exactly when he was taken back. It just says when the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter. So we don't know how old Moses was when he went back. But those years with his parents, he would have been taught the Israelite way. He would have been taught about Israelite history, about the Israelites and what they needed to do, and just how to be a good Jewish person. Now, when he went back with the Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him, he would have learned how to be an Egyptian, how to live as an Egyptian, what he could get away with as an Egyptian, what was expected of him, who their gods were, who their deities were, and he would have known both sides. So he may have been a little bit confused as he grew up, as he had these two different sides kind of vying for him. Now, if we go to the next slide, doubt, we're looking at doubt, the phantom menace again. Okay, so Moses, we'll get to right before he flees in chapter 2 again. It says, one day after Moses had grown up, he went out to where his own people, the Israelites, were and watched them at their hard labor. He saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his own people. Glancing this way and that and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. The next day he went out and he saw two Hebrews fighting. He asked the one in the wrong, why did you hit your fellow Hebrew? The man said, who made you ruler and judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me as you killed the Egyptian? Then Moses was afraid and thought, what I did must have become known. When Pharaoh heard of this, he tried to kill Moses. But Moses fled from Pharaoh and went to live in Midian, where he sat down by a well. There's a lot to unpack in that those verses. Moses was an Egyptian. And when we think of Moses as an Egyptian, he was part of the, adopted into the royal family. We think, okay, it was Pharaoh's daughter who adopted him. So Moses was probably a prince. And that's probably true, except he wasn't at the higher echelon of the royal family. If you think of the English royal family, you have the royals, the queen and the, whatever, her, what is her husband? He's not the king, he's, yeah. So you have them, and then you have William, and you have Charles, and but then you have like these cousins and these other people over here who you hear about once in a while, but you don't think about them unless they do something dumb or illegal or whatever it is. And I think Moses would have been probably more over on the side of the relatives down the row, because if he was the favored even adopted grandchild of the Pharaoh, killing someone probably wouldn't have been that big of a deal. I mean, it would have looked bad maybe, but the Pharaohs were thought of as gods. So what does it matter if one of his heirs would hurt somebody else? It probably wouldn't have mattered that much. But what do we see here? Moses is afraid. He thought, what I did must have become known. And what was he afraid of? Pharaoh killing him. So he flees. But before that, I want to show you what kind of person Moses was. From what we read, what would you say about Moses? What kind of person was Moses from what the verses we just read? What's that? Evil? Hebrew? Yeah, Hebrew. He was, I would say he was what? Impulsive? Imperfect? I would add cold, calculating, a murderer. He didn't do what he did out of the heat of the moment. He looked, let's say, he says, glancing this way and that and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian. He stopped and thought about it. He wanted to make sure that there were no witnesses. He wanted to not get in trouble himself. So he looked this way, he looked that way, he looked behind him to make sure no one was looking. Then he went and he killed the Egyptian who was beating the Israelite. What do we call that nowadays? Premeditated murder. Moses was a murderer. No matter what his anger was, no matter, I don't know if you can say, you know, it's a good thing to kill, or it was good reasoning, but whatever his reasoning was, he killed somebody. When he thought about it, he thought about doing it, and he did it. He knew he was an Israelite. He was upset because the Egyptian was beating an Israelite. So he acted upon that. And what does it say he did? He fled to Midian. Now, if you look at the map, you'll see Egypt is up in the top left-hand corner. Midian is in the bottom right-hand corner. So what's in the middle of all of that, those two? The desert. What happens later in Moses' life? He wanders with the people in that same area. He would have traveled from Egypt. He would have run to Midian to hide. And he was doing his own little exodus over to Midian. And when he got to Midian, he met some ladies at a well. He saved them from some shepherds, and he met the ladies. Then he was able to, he got an invite to the house. He went and he met the father, Jethro. And what was Jethro? He was a priest. So he knew God. He wasn't necessarily an Israelite, but he was a priest, and he was a priest in Midian. So he would have been able to teach Moses about the Lord. Moses married Zipporah,
my mind just went blank. Jethro's daughter. Jethro has three different names in the story, so it gets kind of, he's known by Reuel, he's known as Jethro, and he's known as Hobab. So that's the best one, Hobab. But all three of those, he married the daughter, Moses became a shepherd, and he became a shepherd for his father-in-law. So he went to Midian, and he lived there. Now, how old was he when he ran from Egypt? Anyone know? He was around 40, so he wasn't young. He's grown. He was a grown man. He was 40 when he left. He was in Midian for 40 years, and these are estimates, but Acts actually says he was 40. He spent about 40 years in Midian, and then he went back, and he lived 40 more years after getting the people out of slavery. So when Moses was gone, as we saw, Moses, he was impulsive, he was calculating, he was very kind of, you know, hot-blooded. He got upset with an Egyptian and killed him. He ran and he spent 40 years with his father-in-law and his wife and the family. And Jethro would have been able to teach him, to disciple Moses. And we can see this discipleship dynamic because later in Exodus chapter 18, Moses actually goes, it's after they leave and they're out, they've left, and he's looking for advice, and he goes to Jethro for advice. So we have all that happening. Moses is, he hasn't gone back yet, but he's in Midian. He's learning from from Jethro. He's living, he's being a shepherd. And in verses 23, it says, "During that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out. And their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant with Abraham and Isaac and with Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them." Now, there's four things in each that talks about the Israelites doing some things and God doing some things. There's four things the Israelites do in those verses, three verses, and there's four things that God does in response. The first is the Israelites groaned. They were slaves. They were worked to death. They were not doing well. So they groaned in their slavery. They cried out to God. They cried out for help. And verse 24 says, they groaned again. So they groaned, they cried out for help, and then they groaned some more. And to that, God does four things. God, he heard them, he remembered them, he looked at them, and he was concerned about them. So God met with Moses. God, we don't know God's mind. I don't know if God just said, oh, it's time for Moses to go back. Whatever it was, the time for Moses to go back to Egypt to free the Israelites had come. And God meets with Moses in a burning bush. We can go to the next slide. God meets with Moses in a burning bush. It says, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. And then God goes on to say, I've seen the misery of my people, and it's time to go back. It's time to go back, and I want you to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. Moses was hearing God's voice. When I was younger, I always thought, oh man, if I could just hear an audible voice from God, if I could, God would just tell me what I needed to do with my life, it would be so much easier and I could just go on and do it. Yeah, but I've never heard an audible, some people do. I never did. Here's Moses with God, sitting in front of God. He is with God physically. I mean, God's in the bush burning, but Moses is physically there with God. Yes, and I would like to think that if I was physically in, we are in the presence of God, so I don't know how to say it. God is actually right in front of me telling me to do something. I would say, get out of my way so I can do it. What did Moses do, though? He came up with four excuses. He had doubt. He doubted four different things in this conversation with God. God said, go back and free the people. Stand up to Pharaoh. Get the people out of there. And Moses said, I don't know. If we look at Exodus 3:11, God is telling Moses to go and take the people to the land, take the people out of Egypt and into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, Perizzites, Hittites, or Hivites, the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. You would expect Moses' response. Well, I would expect Moses' response to be to say, okay, let me go, let me do this. But Moses in verse 11 says, well, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? I guess that's a fair question. You know, I was there. I messed up. I had to leave. Who am I to go back? But God says, I will be with you. And this will be a sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Okay, great. God answered my question. That's God's with me. I can do it. But Moses in verse 13 says, well, I'm going to read in a whiny voice because that's how I hear it. Well, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, well, what's his name? Well, what am I going to say? Only thing that's holding me up now, God, is what's your name? And God says, I am who I am. This is what you are saying to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation. And then he gives instructions on what Moses is to do once he's talking to the Israelites, and how the verse 18 says, the elders of Israel will listen to you. Then you and the elders will go to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews has met with us. Let us take a three-day journey into the wilderness to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand and I will strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. Great! God is going to make it so I, Moses, don't have to worry about a thing. He's going to lead me. And I am going to go do what God wants me to. But in chapter 4, verse 1, Moses doubts the Israelites. He says, well, what if they don't believe me? Or what if they don't listen to me? What if they say, the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? A staff, he replied. The Lord said, throw it on the ground. Moses threw it on the ground and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. So Moses reached out and took a hold of the snake and turned it back into a staff in his hand. This, said the Lord, is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has appeared to you. Great! God is with me, and now I have this swell little, not a trick, that's not a good word, but this miraculous thing to show them so they will believe that God has sent me. I can go now. But we read farther down. God is telling Moses, if the people don't believe you or they don't pay attention to that sign, they may believe a second. So if they don't believe the first one, I'm going to give you a backup. But if they do not believe these two signs, or listen to you, take some water from the Nile and pour it on the dry ground, and the water you take from the river will become blood on the ground. And sorry, he's already given him a second one. This is the third one. The second is to put your hand inside your cloak. It'll become leprous, and you put it back in, and it's white as snow. Then he gives them the third one about the water into blood. So he's got these three proofs that God has talked to him. So Moses has no excuse to not go. God is going to be with him. God has given them these signs. And Moses can go to the Israelites and to the Egyptians and say, let my people go. But now Moses says probably what has been on his mind the whole time. In verse 10. Moses said to the Lord, pardon your servant, Lord. I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. Moses doubts his own ability. Moses says, I don't think I can do it. And God says, who gave human beings their mouths? Who makes them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight and makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. And now we get to probably the exact reasoning. This is probably the closest Moses comes to being honest with himself. And he says, pardon your servant, Lord, but please send someone else. In other words, I don't want to go. I have a nice life here. I left Egypt because they were trying to kill me. I have a nice life here. I have a great father-in-law. I have a great wife. I have sons. I have sheep. I'm a shepherd. I have everything I need here. And that's me assuming what Moses was thinking, but I would assume that's what it was. He just does not want to go back. Please send someone else. And the Lord even answers this one. But his anger burned against Moses, and God said, what about your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on his way to meet you, and his heart will be glad when he sees you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. But he will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hand, and you can perform the signs with it. So Moses finally is, his doubts are gone. The doubts he had in himself and the Israelites and his abilities and his speaking abilities, everything has been, God answered everything for him. And he ends up going back to Egypt. And that part we will look at next week. But I want to look at doubt. The doubt that Moses has. And our doubt too. I'm sure we all have doubts. It might not be about God, but it might be about other things in our life. It might be about our abilities at work. It might be about our abilities at home. But just doubt that we have. And there's nothing wrong with doubt. There isn't. There's nothing wrong with having a doubt, but we have to handle it correctly. We have to do something with that doubt. If we just hold on to that doubt, it can become a reality. I don't think that I can speak in front of people, so I'm not going to try. That'll become a reality because we don't try. The important thing with our doubts is who we go to with them. What do we do with those doubts? We need to take those doubts and give it to God. We need to pray and ask for help. We need to pray and do something with those doubts. I want to look at Matthew 14. Matthew 14, 22. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside to pray by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid. Lord, if it is you, Peter said, tell me to come to you on the water. Come, Jesus said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately, Jesus reached out with his hand and caught him. You of little faith, he said, why did you doubt? And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Why did you doubt me? What did Peter do? He said, Lord, call me out. Let me walk on the water with you. Jesus said, fine, come. Peter steps out of the boat. But the wind came up. The rain was probably coming down. The wind was there. And he looked away. And what happened? He began to sink. And how did he come out of that doubt? The doubt that he had when he looked away from Jesus and thought, I'm sinking. What was the only way he could get out of the sinking? to reach out to Jesus again, to cry out to Jesus. And what did he shout? Lord, save me. Lord, take this doubt away from me. I looked away. I went with the weather. I went where the wind, literally, he went where the wind was blowing him. And he cried out, just like Moses. Moses had many doubts, many fears, and he was going to give God every single one of them until God said, fine, I'll find someone else. But that wasn't God's plan. And Moses, God answered every one of Moses' doubts, every one of Moses' challenges. And Moses got it from God. Moses' doubts dissipated because God, he was there with God. He reached out and told God of his doubts. And God took each and every one of them away. Just as Jesus lifted Peter up when Peter yelled, save me. As we go into the further weeks of this sermon series, we're going to see that Moses leads the people, but he's not always perfect. He doesn't always do the right thing. And one of the wrong things he does keeps him out of the promised land. But his doubts were answered. Now, I want you to think in your life, what are your doubts? What doubts do you have in your life? How do they affect you? How do they keep you from what God has for you to do? Like I said, your doubt might not be about God. Hopefully, if you're here and you're listening or you're watching, you believe, you have faith, but your doubt might be in yourself. Your doubt might be in other people. And I want you to think about that. What can you do in order to get rid of those doubts? To get rid of whatever it is between you and what God has for you to do, has for you to move forward in the life of holiness, to move towards the kingdom. And right now, I just want you to think about that. Is there something you need to pray about? Is there something you need to cry out to God and just say, God, take this doubt from me? Like Moses, I'm giving it up to you. Please help me with it. And I want to, if we go to the next, John Bunyan had a great quote. Be careful not to shut your soul's door through doubt when God has just opened it by his grace. God gives us his grace, his unmerited favor. Yet we shut that door with our doubts, with our fears, with whatever it is. And we need to clean all that out. And we need to keep that door, that's our soul's door, open. Ways to deal with doubt. Again, I don't know what happened to the writing, but the first is to admit your doubts and ask for help. Admit to God that you know what your doubts are. Maybe even ask, if you're feeling very daring. Ask in prayer what is separating you, what doubts are separating you, and then ask for help with those. You can, I don't like air quotes, but you can borrow faith by hanging around those whose faith is strong. If you need faith, if you need to be stronger and to get away with doubts, hang around with people who are strong in the faith. Even if just a little bit rubs off, you're better off than where you were. Act on your faith, not on your doubts. We all have faith. We all have doubts. But if we act on our doubts, we're getting farther away from where we should be. Act on your faith. The fifth one that Dr. Ray Pritchard says is, sing. Miriam's not here today. Is Miriam here? Miriam talked to me about singing and how she likes to sing. And as you're watching, Miriam, I hope you don't mind me sharing, but she sings. I think we all know she sings. But she sings when she's feeling down, or she just sings. And we can do that too, whether your voice, it says make a joyful noise to the Lord, not a perfect voice, you don't have to be able to perfectly sing. God looks at our heart. Let go of what you cannot know with certainty. How many of us are afraid of things that we don't even know are going to happen? That guy looked at me weird. Is he going to come chase me? Whatever it is. There's enough to worry about that we actually know about, not to make stuff up in our heads. Let go of what we cannot know with certainty. And the last one is, keep going back to what you know to be true. What do we know to be true? Where is our faith? Jesus Christ. Keep going back. If you have doubts and you're starting to be led by your doubt, pull back. Go back to what you know for certainty and give it up. Give it to Jesus. Talk to other Christians about it to get help with it. But give it up to Jesus Christ. If you have any doubts, I would ask you to come forward. If you have any problem, if you have any lack of faith, anything that's keeping you separated from what God has for you to do, ask, come forward, come pray. Give them up to God. I'm not going to say they're going to poof, go away. They might be something to work on, but give them up to God. The altars are here. You can pray while I'm talking. You can pray afterwards. You can pray during any time. We're taught never to say the altars are open now, because the altars are always open. To pray, to lift up to God, to be in God's presence in this mighty, special way. We're always in God's presence. But the altar is just a place where we can go to fully concentrate, to lift up things. It's a holy place, a set-apart place. What are your doubts today, and what are you going to do with them? Let's pray. Father God, we come to you this morning, and we just lift up the doubts that we have. We lift up anything that might stand between you and us and what you would have for us to do. Father, as we looked at Moses and we studied about his doubts, he was in your physical, actual, whatever presence. You were right there, Lord. Help us. We are in your presence as well. Lord, we just lift up our doubts to you, whatever they might be. Help us in a mighty way to just get rid of those doubts so we can follow you in a mighty, mighty way. And be your light to the world, Lord. God, we love you, and we just pray this in your name. Amen. Amen.
I invite you to stand once more for closing service.
Thank you.
Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. And where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Amen. Go with God.